This video goes with section 82 of Hansen and Quinn's Greek and Intensive course and covers more third declension nouns. Hansen and Quinn covers the material on pages 259 to 262. You'll remember these as your third declension endings, and we learned when we first learned the third declension that to find out what stem to put these endings on, you needed to go to the genitive provided in your vocabulary, take off the os from that genitive singular, and add these endings, and the generally speaking accent is persistent. I told you at the time that Greek only has three declensions, and that's true, but the third declension has some extra varieties that you need to be able to handle. So let's start with the first kind that we're going to address here in this section. They are the type mater, matros, he, with the variation even of that with aner, andros, ha. In this case, we'll follow the rule where we'll take the genitive singular, subtract the os to get our stems, and so let's have a place to put those, and we'll start with mother, mater, and we'll put the nominative singular there, and here's our genitive singular, and now here are our stems. We'll go on now to follow the rule and add our endings. And that works fine in the dative singular, but here's what happens in the accusative singular. What we see here is what the linguists like to call the short vowel grade of the stem. In mater, the nominative singular, you saw the long vowel grade with the eta before the rho. For that word, that's the long vowel stem. You saw the zero grade, matros, without any vowel before the rho. And here in the accusative, we get the short vowel grade with matera. The same thing happens with the vocative. We use simply the stem of the short vowel grade to be the vocative. In the nominative plural, we also get the short vowel grade. And in the genitive plural. Then in our damn dative plural, here's what happens. It's supposed to be something like this, but that's unpronounceable. And so Greek adds an alpha for extra pronounceability. And then we go on with the short vowel grade in the accusative plural and the vocative plural. The accent is persistent, sorta. The rule here is that you just have to learn the accent on the nominative singular, and then in the genitive and dative, the accent is on the ultima. In the other words, it's on the second to last syllable, the penult, except for the vocative singular, where it is as recessive as possible. And so there you can see on the entire plural that the accent is on the penult. If we go and look at aner, man or husband, there's the long vowel grade in the nominative singular. And so I'm going to put in the zero grade stem in the rest of the singular, except for the vocative, and I'll go ahead and put the short vowel stem in the vocative singular, and the zero grade for the rest of the paradigm. Now, if I add the endings, it turns out this is actually correct. Aner happens to keep the zero grade throughout the paradigm, with, of course, our favorite exception, the damn dative plural, where we get that same alpha added for pronounceability. But the rest is quite regular with the zero grade stem. Again, our accent is persistent-ish. And again, we get this strange rule where the accent is on the ultima in the genitive and the dative, and on the penult in every other form. Okay, let's look at another variation of the third declension. This one is of the type genos, genus, ta, or Socrates, Socratus, ha. Here, when we look to see what the stem is, we can't really follow the rule that we've gotten used to with the third declension, where we subtract os from the genitive, because there is no os in the genitive singular. But as you can see from the stem that I put over there underneath our lexicon forms, what's hidden in these forms is a stem genes, or Socrates. In other words, there's an S ending to the stem in every single form. But what happens after I put those in, as you can see, because we're in the neuter with genos, I've left it as the same as the nominative in the accusative and the vocative. But if we look, you can see what happens. Let me show you that again. What happens with the genitive singular is genesos, which is what you would expect, drops its intervocalic sigma, and the epsilon and the omicron contract, and that's how you get genus. So the same thing happens in the dative singular. Instead of genesi, you get gene. Instead of genessa in the nominative plural, the intervocalic sigma drops out, the epsilon and the alpha contract, and you get gene. In the genitive plural, again, the intervocalic sigma drops out, the epsilon and the omega contract, and you get genone. In the dative plural, instead of a double sigma, one of them drops out and you get genesi. And then the accusative plural and the vocative plural behave the same way as the nominative plural. The accent is persistent, and so it behaves pretty much as you expect, except in the genitive plural, where, because you've had a contraction, and it would have been on one of those two contracted vowels, it stays on the contracted syllable, and you get genon. Otherwise, it's as you would expect. So that's how it works with neuter nouns of the type genos, genus, ta. With nouns like the name Socrates, we only need the singular, and we have the same reason for becoming a genitive singular in Socrates, with that us ending, and that is a hidden stem in s. So there you can see the form before the intervocalic sigma drops out, it goes away, epsilon and omicron contract, and you get Socrates. I'm putting that stem in the other cases and showing you again what happens. The intervocalic sigma drops out and you get Socrate. The intervocalic sigma drops out, the epsilon and the alpha contract, and you get Socrate. And then in the vocative, the rule with third declension vocatives is that usually it's simply the stem. Well, there's our stem. And so all we really have to do to change it is change that medial sigma to a final one. And that's the vocative of Socrates. Accent is persistent, and so here's how it looks. The exception there, of course, is the vocative, which often has a very recessive accent. Let's move on to nouns of the type polis, polios. Again, we can't really go to our usual rule where we subtract os from the genitive to see what we're supposed to do for a stem for all of the cases and numbers. It's partly with polis because what we have here is a combination of several different stems, a pole version, a pole version, and a pole version. So pretty much you just have to learn this declension. Polis, poleos is pretty easy to see because it's in your lexicon. Now where we get poleos is from this form, or this putative form, with the eta stem, poleos. And what happened for it to become poleos is that the quantities of the eta, which is long, and the omicron, which is short, switched so that the eta became a short epsilon and the omicron becomes a long omega. This is a process called quantitative metathesis, which is really fun to say and a really fun piece of linguistic jargon to show off once you learn it. So that's how you get the genitive singular, and that's actually how to explain the accent on the genitive singular, which breaks the rules for accent, because as you can see, there's an acute on the third to last syllable, but the last syllable is long, and that shouldn't be allowed. But you now know that the last syllable really was short and only looks the way it does for quantitative metathesis. The dative singular comes from the epsilon stem, pole. The accusative singular comes from the iota stem and uses the new ending of the third declension accusative singular, pollen. The vocative singular is simply the stem in the iota version. The nominative plural actually comes from the epsilon stem with the s ending of the nominative plural of the third declension and a contraction. In the genitive plural, polyon, we get the epsilon stem, and even though this really does violate the rules for accent because that omega nu is always long, nevertheless, by analogy with the genitive singular, it keeps its acute on that omicron. Now the dative plural, policy, with the regular ending on the epsilon stem. The accusative plural goes by the same model by analogy with the nominative plural, unlike other alpha sigma third declension accusatives, and so it also has the contraction, and the same with the vocative plural. Now our last variety is the type basileus, basileos, ha. And here we have the same problem, where we don't have an obvious os in the genitive to find our stem. So we get these two stems, partly because we had an original stem that you can see in some places that was eta, and that funny letter that looks like an F, that's a Greek digamma that has a W sound, so basileu. But that letter has dropped out of the dialect that the Athenians spoke, the Attic dialect, and so it's gone. But you can see it and feel it in some places, including in the genitive singular, where there is this idea for the original form of the word, basileos. Then we get quantitative metathesis, and the digamma drops out, and so you get basileos instead of basileos. In the dative singular, we do the same thing. The quantitative metathesis happens again, the digamma drops out, and although you can't really tell it when you're reading it, that would be a long iota. In the accusative singular, we also get the quantitative metathesis, and it's actually a long alpha, but the reason that that epsilon and alpha don't contract, as you've seen in some of the other third declension nouns, even in this video, is because that digamma, that consonant, is actually still felt to be in there and keeping that contraction from happening, as if there's a consonant in between. The vocative is basileu. The nominative plural is basileis or basileis, spelled either way. The genitive plural is basileon, which again has the quantity shift, the quantitative metathesis, with the eon felt as its past, and therefore no contraction. Basileosi for the dative plural, basileas, again instead of basileuas, and we get the quantitative metathesis, which means that, unusual for the third declension, that alpha in the accusative plural is long. And then the vocative plural is the same as the nominative plural. And those varieties of the third declension will now serve you well with a whole bunch of new nouns that you'll be able to decline.